This is Greece. Now, a lot of economic videos have covered the causes of the Greek crisis, though a less answered question is over a decade on, why Greece never really recovered. You see, before the Great Lockdown, Greece's GDP was still 25% below its pre-crisis peak, with unemployment above 20% for most of the last decade. Greece's no-show recovery is unparalleled in modern history, even amongst the most severe depressions. 5 years after the Great Depression, US GDP per capita had risen by 35%. Likewise, after Argentina's 2002 crisis, it was up by 45%. But for Greece, well, GDP per capita rose by less than 6%. A dismal stat for sure, but why? Well, like all good stories, this begins with a bit of background. Why Greece was doomed to fail from the start. Greece's failure to recover stems from its failure to qualify for the euro in the first place. During the 80s and 90s, Greece was racked with high inflation alongside twin deficits in its government spending and trade accounts. Its get out of jail free card was its exchange rate. Need to make the economy more competitive? No problem, just weaken the Greek currency, the drachma, and that should help for a while. The trouble with this strategy, though, is that it failed to address the structural flaws in the Greek economy, and as a result, the Greeks were subject to higher interest rates on debt, which was almost nature's way of keeping excessive borrowing in check. The invisible hand of the free market. So when the EU decided it would be a great idea to launch a currency, which, by the way, would do away with Greece's high inflation, wild exchange rate, and most importantly, give it access to cheap credit, this was too good an opportunity to miss out on. As you can imagine, to help play in the same economic sandpit as the likes of Germany and France, Greece reformed into a stellar economy with sound finances, competitive international trade practices, and economic sustainability. But no, that wasn't to be the case. Instead, Greece decided to cook the books, something the government admitted in 2004, and continued to do so, distorting figures by including black market activities like cigarette smuggling and counterfeit goods. Greece's failure to address its structural issues wasn't a problem as long as credit was cheap and the world economy kept growing. Then 2008 happened, at which point Greece had built an unsustainable level of debt, an economy overinflated on cheap credit, an extremely non-competitive labour market, and little in the way of high-value trade. Now, Greece was hardly the only country to face these problems. If you recall the pigs' economies, of Portugal, Ireland, Italy, and Spain. But there are some important reasons for Greece's lackluster recovery. Why Greece had the perfect model for poor growth. If you've ever had to sit through an Economics 101 class, you may have come across the solo swan growth model. Whilst not perfect, it outlines some fundamental factors an economy requires to grow, including labour, capital accumulation, and population growth. All factors Greece pretty much lacked. Starting with labour, as mentioned earlier, leading up to the crisis, Greece had become uncompetitive, something it could deal with in its pre-euro days through external devaluations of its currency. But being tied to the euro meant that these external devaluations had to become internal, which involved a lot of pain, as average wages and pensions dropped by more than 25%, decimating domestic demand in a country which made a living as a consumption economy. To put just how uncompetitive Greek labour had become into perspective, in the 15 years to 2010, Greece recorded the EU's highest increase in hourly wages for manufacturing at 97%. At the same time, Greek productivity rose by 18%, just a third of the EU's average productivity growth, meaning its relative unit labour costs were rising sharply, quickly becoming uncompetitive. And surprisingly, Greece's productivity didn't improve much after its bailouts began. Between 2010 and 2016, it was the only OECD economy with a negative labour productivity performance. A principal reason for this lies in another solo factor, fixed capital formation, or basically, investment. Fixed capital formation has nearly halved, as businesses invested less, hampering their competitiveness. And this is a crucial point. Until 2018, Greece's foreign direct investment had always been below the EU average, not reaching above 2% of GDP until 2019. In fact, Greece's trend line is almost horizontal, with no sizable increase. One key reason for this lies in Greece's high corporate tax rates, which until recently were amongst Europe's highest, alongside a lengthy bureaucracy which wrapped businesses up for years. Though if there's one thing investors like less than high taxes, it's instability. With Greece's instability, whether through protests, referendums on bailout conditions, or being the first developed country in history to default on its IMF debt, deterring would-be investors for the best part of a decade. Now, on the flip side of investments is savings. Savings are vital for economic activity, helping to expand the capital stock. A good way to think about them is helping to fund investments, as one person's savings become another's source of capital. Unfortunately for Greece, it has the lowest savings rate in the EU, being the only nation to have a negative savings rate for the whole of the 2010s. Something which is less a reflection of a lavish lifestyle and more a necessity to compensate for savage wage cuts, high taxes, and painful austerity. The scale of this pain has had a severe impact on Greece's population numbers. Which brings us nicely onto our last solo model factor, population growth, or in Greece's case, a lack of it. As the no-growth recovery grinded on, Greece's population has started to shrink, thanks in part to possessing the second oldest population in Europe, just after Italy's, and in part due to the immigration of 5% of its population. Amongst them, many of the most skilled, educated, and productive, a brain drain of epic proportions. It's no coincidence that Greece's population peaked in 2010, during the beginning of its financial crisis. So given all of this, Greece surely has some go-to industries to help grow its economy. What's the issue with Greece's main export industries? If you think about Greece, tourism often springs to mind, and this is an industry that Greece is great at, welcoming record numbers of tourists every year since 2011, a sector which accounts for an estimated quarter of GDP. So if it's so successful, with the number of tourists doubling over the last decade, why hasn't it saved Greece's economy? Tourism is typically a low value-add industry. Wages just aren't that high, as productivity gains are fairly low. So when it accounts for a quarter of GDP, static incomes become a wider community trajectory. And as a seasonal industry, unemployment fluctuates widely compared to the job security industrialization brings. An economy built off tourism, as opposed to industrialization, misses out on a lot of wider drivers that come along with it, like improvements to infrastructure, institutions, governance, and skills. So whilst tourism is a bright spot for Greece's economy, its record-setting performance can't compensate for the structural issues which come along with it. Now, despite exporting relatively little, Greece plays an essential role in facilitating international trade, being a world leader when it comes to maritime trade, controlling over a quarter of deep-sea shipping and over half of the EU's fleet, a position built on its strategic location, seafaring history, and geography, deemed so crucial to the nation by the state that tax breaks to shipowners are enshrined in the Greek constitution. However, the actual contribution shipping makes to the economy is hotly debated, particularly in light of years of austerity, which shipping was largely exempt from. According to the industry, it accounts for over 6% of GDP, being a vital source of foreign currency. Though critics state this is largely a myth, being down to the way Greece accounts for it. You see, if it counted only the payments to companies and individuals in Greece, like other countries, then it would be around 1% of GDP, as much of the activity in shipping doesn't happen in the country. Most ships rarely even dock in a Greek port. A lot of the repairs, maintenance, and even the crews are from abroad, not to mention the offshore holdings, an activity which occurs in international waters. The point being here, the impact of the sizable industry and a key export market may be less important than some like to believe. Though Greece's non-recovery isn't entirely to do with its structural issues, it's partly to do with how it was bailed out, how Greece's bailouts impact its recovery. Greece received the largest loan in human history. In fact, it received three separate bailouts to cover its unsustainable debt pile, which all go a long way to explain its lack of recovery. These bailouts came at a cost: austerity. In return for saving the nation from crashing out of the euro, it agreed to brutal austerity cuts to wages, pensions, and higher taxes. As already stated, these crushed demand in a consumption-based economy. Yet, as always, the devil is in the detail. An important condition of these bailouts was Greece's agreement to run a huge surplus in its government finances, at 3.5% until 2022, and then 2.2% until 2060. On the face of it, it seems sensible enough. We'll give you a bailout if you promise not to rack up more debt. But, and there is a big but here, the sustainability of maintaining such large surpluses has been called into question, as ultimately, these surpluses require the state to significantly scale back spending on all sorts of programs, imposing more taxes. Even the IMF has challenged whether any economy can sustain such a strict budget in the long run. To put it in context, an IMF study covering 90 countries between 1945 and 2015 found only 13 cases where a surplus above 1.5% of GDP could be maintained for just 10 years. But what about Greece's 3.5%? Well, then the cases dropped to just 3, and only one country if you exclude resource-rich ones, which pretty much makes it mission impossible. One made even tougher by the fact Greece's debt is mainly foreign-held, meaning debt repaid is less likely to be recycled back into the economy, which is unlike the high debts of other sovereign nations, such as Japan, where largely domestic institutions and investors hold the debt. However, things may not be all that bad for Greece. Before the Great Lockdown, it looked like it was finally turning a corner. 2020 was predicted to be a great year for Greece. Confidence was returning, a load of economic indicators were picking up, and the Athens Stock Exchange had been the world's best performer in 2019. Even its banking sector, long plagued by non-performing loans, had risen by over 100% in cases. Part of this change had been the result of a new government, set to make the economy more competitive through a whole raft of measures. Yet fundamentally, a lot of the investment Greece had seen over the years was hot money, looking to profit from assets undervalued by a long economic depression being traded at fire sale style prices. Structural barriers still persist, such as its negative trade account after nearly a decade of proposed reform, high unemployment, and a large investment gap. So overall, even before the Great Lockdown, Greece's economy was still roughly a quarter smaller than its pre-crisis peak. For a time, its structural weaknesses had been hidden by cheap credit and a booming world economy. But when the good times were over, its unsustainability became clear. What nobody could predict, though, was how long it would take to get back on track. Something explained by factors like an uncompetitive labour market, falling investment, and population decline. Whilst Greece has often looked to its tourism and shipping sectors as champions of export, with both sectors being a success story over the last decade, the extent of their benefits has been called into question. Ultimately, Greece is still very much in its recovery a decade on. A real odyssey, though if there's one thing the Greeks know, it's how to fight back. The sacrifices the average Greek has had to make over the last 10 years are testament to just that. Now it's over to you. Will Greece finally be able to emerge from the greatest depression in living memory? Can they address their economic issues? Are you from Greece or been there recently? We're keen to hear what your thoughts are in the comments below. The Alt Simplified team have really enjoyed making this video, and we hope you've enjoyed watching it just as much. If you think we've earned it, consider subscribing and leaving us a like. It really helps grow this channel. And as always, see you in the next video.